Welcome to my series of conversations with men and women whose ideas, vision, and philosophy define our contemporary world. My guest today is one of the great legends of yoga. He's taught yoga at centers and students across the world. He's brought new insight, innovation, and application for yoga. I'm delighted to welcome Sri Keshavacharya. So when I wanted to address you as guru, you said, "Don't do that." Why was that? And who and what is a guru? You're such a renowned teacher. You have so many students. You're held in such regard. Why this diffidence about being addressed as a guru?
The word guru has become a doubtful expression. Why is that? Because everybody calls guru. You know, because if you have the word guru, they think it will be good for business. When I taught J. Krishnamurti in 1966, J. Krishnamurti, as you know, is a great philosopher. He liked me so much, and he had some health problem. And as his health got improved, he began to ask a lot of questions about yoga. And then he said, "Sir, I want to ask you a small favor. Never ever become a guru."
Well, you know, Krishnamurti frequently used the phrase and sort of the appendage, "Sir," so I shall address you as "Sir." Sir, tell me that in the teaching of yoga, you have brought great emphasis on the personalization of the teaching, that, you know, each individual is different and he needs his own formula of teaching and practice. How do you respond to sort of the mass yoga that we now see? You know, we often see images and photographs of contemporary younger yoga teachers with 1,000 people performing yoga at the same time. What are the implications of something like that, of mass yoga?
There are two tracks. One is information. The other is called transformation. With information, we can communicate to thousands of people. With transformation, it is almost like surgery, where we cannot do operation, one doctor cannot do surgery for 1,000 people. When it comes to transformation, there is a need for one-to-one contact. For example, if I have to teach somebody who has a faith in God, I have to honor that person. If I have to teach somebody else who has no faith in God, we have to respect that person's view. If I insist you must believe in God, we have no connection. That's why for transformation to happen, there should be an intimate relationship between the aspirant and the provider. That's why it is a one-to-one connection.
Is this aspect of information then dangerous? You know, you perform complex asanas on television, on books, and people seek to replicate those. Does that have sort of implications that it might be harmful for people?
We are becoming yoga mechanics for people who go to these mass classes, get into trouble, and then come to us and we repair their body. Because imagine there are thousands of people of different background, different age, different structure, and they are taught the same thing. For example, sometimes they teach a bellow breathing 100, 200 times. Somebody may have a low blood pressure or anemic condition. They may get hyperventilated. They may collapse. Somebody with a high blood pressure, when they do that, they may get some stiffness in the neck. And somebody with a big obese sponge, when they do this thing, they may get cramp in the stomach and sometimes even lose motion. That's happening. But fine, people are tempted by popularity. So they do go to that in thousands, and when they get into trouble, we do the mechanical job.
Sir, tell me that, yoga has traditionally been sort of looked at as deriving almost exclusively, every yoga teacher claims inspiration and guidance from the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. Your father, Krishnamacharya, who is a great master, was also influenced by, you know, the texts of Nathamuni. And in a sense, you have expanded the understanding of yoga. So in what ways has this happened, this enlarging of the circle of the understanding and the application of yoga that you follow and you teach?
One thing that often is happening about yoga is a projection that yoga is about just postures, body, postures, kriyas and all that. Patanjali's definition of yoga is body is like an instrument. But the focus must be, we must discipline the mind. We must have a quiet mind. We should not have an agitated mind. So any tools that help us to quieten the mind, any tools that reduces the agitation of the mind must be tried. Once that is tried, we will have a peace. Unfortunately, today, yoga has been often confused to posture. This style, that style, that style. And it is very sad it is happening. Patanjali's definition is yogaha chitta vritti nirodhaha. Yoga is to focus all the activities of the mind on a chosen constructive direction. When that is done, we understand everything. Once that is done, we will have peace. Otherwise, we are in trouble. Many basic definition of yoga has been lost sight by too much of postures.
You're watching a conversation with Desikacharya, Sri Desikacharya, the Guruji, and we'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away. Welcome back to a continuing conversation with the great yoga teacher and master, Sri Desikacharya. So we were talking about Patanjali's emphasis on posture, and you use the chitta vritti and the controlling of the mind and the elements of the mind. In Patanjali, it's very structured. You know, you start with a moral basis, yama, niyama, and then you go on to breathing and pratyahara and the different stages, the structures of this. You have in some literature at least said that, well, the yama and niyamas, the do's and don'ts, the moral framework, is not as significant and is not as detailed, or need not be practiced in as detailed a structure as a prerequisite for yoga. What is the relationship of the moral framework before you approach yoga? Or does through the practice of yoga automatically a moral framework, a moral imperative arise in the individual? What follows and what precedes?
It is not possible to have these considerations when we are agitated. We have seen some people who have such a disturbed mind and had pain, they cannot think of anything. Once the pain is reduced through certain meditation or some breathing practice, sometimes even postures, then they become a little more sensitive to care. I've seen some people who have been so nasty, and through yoga they have been transformed, and they have feeling for the society. They do care for the society. So even though yama niyama, which is social attitude and personal discipline, is emphasized, for that to happen, we need to have a stable mind. Because when I am people always say, when I am suffering, how can I think of others? I want others to help me. So once my suffering is reduced, physically or emotionally or mentally, care takes over.
So in a sense, the you know, the sequencing of this, so you know, I come to you as a patient, let me say, you know, of a disturbed mind, body, you know, physiology and psychology. Where do you begin? Do you begin sort of with working first with my mind, posture, breathing? What is the sequencing of this? You can't really sit down and meditate if your, you know, your body is in a mess, and vice versa. So Patanjali laid down the sequencing, and I think sort of one of the innovations you have brought to this is to sort of rework that sequencing depending on the needs of the individual. Now, how do you decide? You know, where do you start?
The first sutra of Patanjali itself is the guidance. The first sutra says, Atha Yoga Anushasanam.
Atha means I am now ready to listen to you. And the teacher says, I am ready to listen to you. I am ready to pay attention to you. Anushasanam. I am ready to follow your instruction. I am ready to give instruction. What does it mean is, the first requirement when somebody comes for help is, the student or the sick person must like the teacher. If the student or the sick person does not like the teacher, it is not going to work. That's why the first requirement is Anushasanam. I like this person. I trust this person. I will listen to this person. I follow this instruction. That is the first requirement. That is what is called yoga, is relationship. Without relationship, transformation cannot happen.
So I, as a student, have this feel, this great empathy for you. How important is it for you to feel that towards me and to accept me? What, as a teacher, you don't feel the empathy to the student? Does that happen?
Sure, it happens.
The teacher must like the student. The teacher should not abuse the student.
So what are the qualities that you look for in a student? That he likes you, that he has this devotion for you, and that evokes a feeling of reciprocity in you?
I do not treat them as an authority. I always treat them as my friend. I never call my students students. I always say, he's my friend. I never say he's my student. That is called mitra, a loving care. I want to offer a loving care, and that makes a big difference. And sir, today's context, relationship is dwindling. Thanks to computer and all this modern technology, we have lost human connection. I go to a doctor, hardly I will have 2 minutes to see. When I am with a teacher, they are so happy you are giving so much time for me. How is it you are giving so much time for me? So that is what I try. Often I say, good relationship is more effective than right technology. When the relationship is good, a wrong technology will not have so much effect. When the relationship is bad, even the best technology may not work. This has been done in studies also. When I take a medicine and I say, I like this doctor, I'm sure this doctor loves me, I'm sure he's giving me good, and I take this medicine, positive immune system takes over. If I don't like this doctor, he was so nasty, I hate this doctor, I don't know why I should take this medicine, negative emotions take over. These are studies that have been done.
You have, in our conversation, I've noticed that, you know, you have very often broken into the chanting mode, and you are also a great teacher of Vedic chanting. In what way does Vedic chanting juxtapose, coexist with the practice of yoga?
In one of the terms Patanjali uses in transformation of mind is called Swadhyaya. It is in the second chapter. Tapaha Swadhyaya Ishvara Pranidhanani Kriya Yogaha. Patanjali says, when the mind is agitated, use 3 steps. Reduce your impurities. Do some recitation. Then don't be greedy on all actions. Be patient. Tapas means reduction of impurities. Swadhyaya is chanting that we like. Ishvara Pranidhana is, whatever we do, we must not say, I'm going to win. Nothing is in our hand. It is almost like Karma Yoga. So Swadhyaya is chanting that we like. It is not that we have to do only Hindu chanting. Any chanting that we like has such an effect. Sometimes I teach Christians some Christian chanting. You know, for example, there was one lady who had a divorce, and she was so much in a mess. She was a Roman Catholic. So I said, why don't you pray for Jesus Christ? And I composed a poem for her. Señor Jesus, you are my only hope.
Señor Jesus, I trust you completely. Señor Jesus, stay with me forever. Señor Jesus, now I am quiet. Señor Jesus, now I am confident. This is what I taught her. And she did it, and it gave a connection to her. Of course, we have a lot of chanting in India. For example, we had a person who had a breast cancer. And I said, when you go to the doctor, I will do some prayer for you. She was a Hindu. And I said, this is a prayer that tells, let nature heal me.
Agnirme vachishritaha vakhrudaye hrudayam mayi aham amrute amrutam brahmani vayurme prane shritaha prano hrudaye hrudayam mayi aham amrute amrutam brahmani suryo me chakshushi shritaha chakshur hrudaye hrudayam mayi aham amrute amrutam brahmani etc.
I taught her this chanting. Today she's completely all right.
We'll come right back in a moment and talk more about chanting. You're watching A Conversation with Sri Desikacharya. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away. Welcome back to a continuing conversation with the great yoga master and Vedic chanter, Sri Desikacharya. We're talking about chanting, and you gave us two wonderful illustrations, one from the Christian tradition and one from the Vedic traditions. How does chanting work? How does it sort of affect the physiological, psychological transformation that it obviously does? What are the mechanics of it? And I ask this question to you both as a teacher of yoga and a traditional practitioner, but also in a sense a scientist by training. I mean, you studied engineering, and so you really approach this also with the empiricism of logic, reason, and the scientific vocabulary. So how do you bridge these two?
It is a remarkable thing. It's almost like when somebody has a positive feeling. For example, some people go to the Ganga River in Varanasi and dip in the river. Even if it is impure, they have a feeling it is a holy river. With that attitude, when they go dip in the Ganga River, they feel cleansed. It is not chemically true, you know. Similarly, when some chanting is done, and we say this is a chanting that has come from a great master, and they have refined it, and there has been some claims made that chanting removes all the toxins, chanting gives us some power from the sound of the chanting, like
Buddham Sharanam Gacchami, Sangam Sharanam Gacchami, Dharmam Sharanam Gacchami.
When we say that, the moment we think of Buddha, we get linked to Buddha. What a model Buddha is. That is what is called a connection.
Is there something happening with the vibrations or the sounds that we're using that affect the biochemistry of the brain? You know, it's a similar analogy with the use of mantra, for example, that also has an audio quality vibration to it, even when it's not verbalized. So in a sense, chanting doesn't always have to be verbalized and spoken out loud. It can be an internal sub-vocalization of it. So when is there a difference between the effects of an external verbalizing and internal verbalizing? What are the nuances of this?
My experience has been, for example, I will give an extraordinary example, sir. On September 11th, on that evil day, I was in Atlanta. And it happened. And I could not get any flights. I could not call anybody. My wife was in Oklahoma. My son was in New York. My daughter also was in Oklahoma. I could not call anybody. I thought I am not disturbed. But subconsciously, I was disturbed. I could not even cook properly. And then all my flights were canceled. And then I said, what can I do? Should I go back to India or should I stay here? I was very agitated. And then I went for a walk. And then I sat under a tree. And when I was walking, everybody was looking at me suspiciously because, you know, my color is all, I'm like an Arab. And then I sat there and I began to do some chanting. And as I began to do chanting, first I could not do chanting, but I persisted. And as I chanted and chanted, I had total silence. I had so much silence. And because of that silence, mental silence, I got some clarity. I must stay in America. I must heal those people who are wounded. I decided to stay in America. And as I was chanting, all those people who looked at me suspiciously, when they heard my chanting, they all stood there and listened to me. And I said, thank you for chanting. Today, I am more rested. Chanting gives silence. It is a silence like when we are running a car. If you continuously run the car, it is not good. You have to stop the car for some time. That's what is called chanting, is a mental silence. When there is a mental silence, mind recovers.
In terms of this practical dimension of moving from the external chanting to the internalization of it, what happens?
In the beginning, we have to chant loudly. It's called Uchai. Then, when you have chanted properly, loudly, you chant softly. For example, first level. Tat Savitrum Varenyam. We can't make a mistake. Once you are chanting well, we are allowed to say Tat Savitrum Varenyam. Then chant mentally. Mental chanting must be exactly the way we must chant loudly. So the first training is loud chanting, then soft chanting, then mental chanting.
How important is correct pronunciation? Because what I get from you is that intention and the faith that this is a tradition, that this is going to make an impact, is extremely important. How critically important is the accuracy and the precision of pronunciation?
I have to call you Mr. Malhotra. Suppose I call you Meghotra, it will not be proper. That is why right chanting is also something that I am respecting. Right chanting is something I am very attentive. This way the Vedic chanting has notes. See, ha, it is a verification that my chanting, rightly done, is a reflection of I have total attention. That's why we are trained. When we are trained chanting, the teacher will recite once and the student has to recite three times. And all the three times, there should be no mistake.
So in this context of the precision and the use of language, you use this chanting that you taught this woman in the Christian tradition.
Yes, yes.
So what happens there? How does that begin to work? You know, there it's obviously using everyday vocabulary, apart from the association with Jesus and Christ. So it isn't really the sort of the auditory effect implications of the sound of the word, or of sort of great historical significance. So obviously there is a secular dimension to chanting. that's not restricted to just what derives from Vedic authority or Vedic tradition. How do you relate the two, and how do they both work differently?
Yeah, I also want to add something. Chanting should not be like a parrot chanting. We have to have a feeling of what is that chanting. We must, when we chant, we should understand what it means. What is its significance? It's called bhavana. When we chant something, we have to visualize what this chanting is about. For example,
Tat Savitrum Varenyam.
It is a Gayatri. It means, I, Son, I praise you because you are our Creator. So when we are chanting, we should not only chant mechanically, we should have a feeling of what it is about.
Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi.
You, Son, you are so powerful. You can remove impurities even of the Divine. So if you can remove the impurities of the Divine, it is so easy for you to remove us. We are simple people.
Dhiyo yo na prachodayat.
Having meditated on you, we now are sure we will have total clarity and total courage. So we also chant with some feeling of what we are chanting about. It should not be a mechanical chanting.
So in conclusion, is there a very simple secular chant that you can give us, demonstrate, simple, that our viewers can recall, listen to, and use?
Asato ma sadgamaya tamaso ma jyotirgamaya mrityorma amritangamaya.
It's a neutral chanting which says, lead us from ignorance to correct perception. Lead us from darkness to light. Lead us from fear to total confidence.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Malhotra.
Back to us in the program.
Thank you very much, sir. Namaskar.